Dr. S. G. V. Subramaniam is currently working as professor in the Environmental Studies Department of Anna University, Chennai. He has done 8 master's degree including MBA, 6 postgraduate diplomas, a degree in law and doctor of philosophy in the field of environmental management and environmental law. He has done his postdoctoral work in France under the Indo-French Cultural Exchange Fellowship and at Germany under the DAD Fellowship. He has been awarded UN Fellowship and done diploma in international lawmaking and diplomacy from the University of Joensuu, Finland. He is involved in several environmental impact assessment related consultancy works. He has guided several students for their master's degree program project works. To his credit, nearly 77 papers have been published and presented in various national and international conferences. He has been nominated by His Excellency Governor of Tamil Nadu as Senate member for 2 terms to the Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University. He has been nominated as expert member for the State Environmental Appraisal Committee for 2 terms by the Government of India. He has served as member board of studies in the Legal Studies Department of University of Madras. Right now, he has been nominated as member board of studies in the field of environmental studies in the Thiruvalluvar University. He has written several chapters in the leading books in the field of environmental law.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series on environmental science. In continuation of our episode, Environmental Management and Development, we were discussing about the carbon footprint. Now, we will move to the part 2 of the carbon footprint. The contents which we are going to discuss now. Number 1, construction industry and its footprints. Construction industry to minimize the footprints. Why? Now, climate change is increasingly recognized as one of the greatest challenges facing humanity today. This is what I have explained in my previous episode. What are the effects of the greenhouse gases? What are the various gases which are causing the greenhouse effect? And what is the global warming, ozone depletion? All these things we have discussed in our previous episode. Now, the main influence on the carbon footprints include population, economic output, and energy, and carbon intensity of the economy. This is the most important. When any industry which is more a carbon intensive one means it is not so energy efficient because more amount of the carbon is being released into the atmosphere. These factors are the main targets of individuals and businesses in order to decrease the carbon footprint. If the quantum of the carbon in the form of any gases which is being released into the atmosphere means there that particular industry's carbon footprint is more. So, that industry has to reduce this carbon footprint, or the necessity of increasing the carbon footprint is very much stressed because of its over release of the greenhouse gases. The most effective way to decrease a carbon footprint is either decrease the amount of energy needed or the production or to decrease the dependence on the carbon emitting fuels. So, in the first point, I said decrease in the carbon footprint, either decrease the amount of energy needed. So, your process must be in such a way that the energy requirement must be as less as possible or as minimum as possible. The second way to decrease the carbon footprint is to decrease the dependence on the carbon emitting fuels. So, what are all those carbon emitting fuels? Mainly the fossil fuels. So, if your dependence on the carbon fuels are reduced, if you could switch over to the alternative fuels like a solar energy, tidal energy, wind energy, so that the quantum of releasing of the carbon into the atmosphere is lessened, with the result, whatever that footprint you are leaving with reference to the carbon, that is namely the carbon footprint, is very much reduced. The overwhelming scientific consensus that the earth climate is changing and the most of the observed increase of the temperature is very likely due to human caused greenhouse gas emissions. It is needless to say, it is a proved fact that there is an increase in temperature. Now, this increasing temperature may be due to the natural phenomenon as well as the human induced one. But the quantum of the natural phenomenon which is causing that increase in temperature is less when compared to the human induced one. This has been proved beyond all doubts for that matter. Now, looking forward, the businesses will encounter significantly increased pressure to reduce their contribution to the climate change. Because if the climate change is going on taking place on one hand, in our previous episode, I have very much clearly said what are the various effects of the climate change. Number one, it will be increasing the global temperature. When the global temperature is increased, even there will be the glaciers will start melting. And in some of the places, even some of the low-lying islands or even some of the countries may likely to submerge inside the water. Secondly, because of the increase in temperature, the agriculture will get affected. The crop pattern will get affected. And in fact, some of the vector-borne diseases, especially with reference to the mosquitoes like malaria, filaria, that and all with dengue fever, that and all will be increasing. Because increase in temperature will be leading to the mosquito breeding in a more accelerated form. So, for that reason, the global warming has to be given the due importance, or we have to reduce the emission of the greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, with the result that is an increase in the pressure amounting to the various businesses to reduce the emission of the greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. A greater degree of the scrutiny of their carbon footprint. For that, they have to make a self-evaluation whether on what degree they are causing the carbon footprint. They have to evaluate. That self-evaluation is very, very essential. Then the third point, need to demonstrate environmentally responsible practices to remain competitive in the marketplace. Now, environmentally friendly or environmentally responsible practices, if A industry and B industries are there, if the A industry could be able to practice more environmentally friendly method of their manufacturing process, then the B one naturally will be A will have a cutting edge in their market than the B, because that is also one of the greatest thing which is affecting the market economy nowadays, not only at the regional level but also in the global level. As such, responding to climate change will be one of the major issues affecting the businesses over the next decade and beyond. So, here the climate change is going to be the major factor which is going to affect the business in the coming years. If the contribution of the greenhouse gases is very much reduced, that companies will be going to survive, and those companies will be very much recognized, and those companies will have a good marketing cutting edge than the companies which are not practicing a good housekeeping practices, whereby the emission of the greenhouse gases is reduced. Right. In the very near future, all facilities will be required to know and report their carbon footprint as part of their social responsibility and asset management. Now, this point I would like to explain. The day is not far, that is, every company has to report, has to maintain, first of all, they has to maintain what quantum of the carbon dioxide, or for that matter, any of the greenhouse gases they are emitting into that atmosphere. Secondly, they have to maintain that record. With the result, we can find it out what amount of the carbon footprint they are leaving into the atmosphere. This is becoming a social responsibility, and it will become an asset management. If they wanted to manage their assets, not only the natural one, even to the human resources one, if they wanted to manage more effectively and efficiently, this will become major factor in the industry in the coming decades. Now, how far our regulatory environment is playing the role? That is, or we can say how the regulatory environment or the regulatory regime can make this point a more effective one. First, more stringent greenhouse gas emission policies in the future. Now, every country will have their own policy. Every policy in the sense, they will be having their own vision. How to reduce, or what environmentally efficient management practices to be followed by the industry. Like that, they have to draft a policy. This is nothing but the vision of the particular government of the particular country. Now, more if the country could be able to devise, if the country could be able to draft a policy in such a way that more stringent greenhouse gas emission policies are there, with the result this gas releasing can be very much reduced. Only thing, those countries not only devising the policy but also enacting the various legislations, and not only enacting but a proper enforcement of these legislations, which is very much essential. More so, it is not only the regulatory one, that people's acceptance is also very much important, or otherwise we can say that the social impact of that one also we have to take into consideration. We cannot immediately implement in anything abruptly in any country at any given point of time. We have to slowly switch over from the lower one to the higher one. So, based upon that only, we can able to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions. For that, we have to devise the policy, enact our legislations that must have a good social acceptance. It must be to a large extent industries friendly for that matter. These initiatives are expected to exceed voluntary initiatives and incentives favored in the past. Here, if a company is taking more pain or adopting more advanced technology, thereby it is reducing the carbon footprint, means that particular industry have to be properly recognized by giving more economic incentives. Here only the carbon trading comes. Now this is the becoming the talk of the town, or not only the talk of the town, it is the talk of the globe, that is the carbon trading. It is economically feasibility of that carbon trading, then the social acceptability of that one, depending upon the country, we have to slowly enforce it. Third one, policy measures likely to emerge include carbon taxes that penalize greenhouse gas emitters. Here, the policy matter, the policy must be devised in such a way that your greenhouse gases are limited for the particular industry, for the particular period of time, this is the quantum of that one. If that particular industry exceeds its limitation, then the country have, that the industry has to be penalized. That is number one. Second one, you can give, if the country is reducing, then its limit which is being prescribed, then the particular industry have to be rewarded. So, you have to blend properly the economic regime as well as the penalizing regime, or the regulatory one must be in such a way that economic aspects must be integrated into the system. Then emission trading schemes that target specific sectors. Emission trading, this is what I have just said previously, that a particular industry which has got the license for the emission, this is the quantum of the carbon that the industry could able to release, for that it has got the permission or the permit. If the industry inducted certain advanced technology so that it has reduced the quantum of carbon it is released into the atmosphere, whatever that carbon which is being saved by that particular industry, now that particular industry is empowered to sell that carbon to some other industry. With the result, this industry is getting an economic cutting edge or an economic advantage over the other industry. So, this is where that economic regime has to be blended with our enforcement regime. Carbon emission policies could significantly increase costs and reduce the competitiveness, especially if regulations are not applied evenly around the world. So, here there is a transition at the world level is very much stressed. For example, if one country could be able to adopt, if the neighboring country is not adopting, means there will not be a much gain for the country which is adopting it. So, what that point I would like to stress here is, now not only a single country, it must be slowly percolating to the global level or with reference to all the countries, then only we can have a safe and a clean environment. What we are, from the beginning, what we are stressing is, think globally and act locally. So, you have to think at the global level, and if you could act at the local level, with the result the local will add it together, finally it will become the global. Then companies that lead the way in proactive emissions reductions in anticipation of a new regulatory environment may develop a significant competitive advantage. This is what I have said in the previous point, that if the company could be able to adopt certain advanced measures anticipating that this is going to happen, with the result that company will have a cutting edge over the other countries with reference to the carbon footprint, and that can be converted into the economic things, with the result the company could save lot of money and other resources. Then let us see, so far we have seen with reference to the industrial point of view. Now let us look into the consumer point of view, or the consumer values. First one, public concerns regarding the negative impacts of climate change have moved to the forefront of consumer consciousness. Here that consumers are becoming every day more awareness, and the consumers have every day by day their environmental consciousness is very much increasing. To quote that, even in India, we have developed the Consumer Protection Act. Now the day is not far. A consumer can claim whether the particular product is environmentally friendly, or whether you have done that life cycle assessment for the project, for the particular product. So the day is not far. In that case, there is a good amount of the public concern is there. When the public has got a good amount of awareness, means automatically the industry is forced to switch over environmentally friendly technology, or that the technology must be in such a way which has got a less carbon footprint than the other industries. Then even media coverage of environmental disasters like hurricanes like Katrina is serving to elevate the sense of urgency among the citizens to act on the environmental concerns. See, if you could be able to read the newspapers or see the mass media, that is print and the other media, a good amount of publicity or good amount of sensitiveness, good amount of the awareness is being created even for the natural disasters. With the result, the citizens have got more awareness and citizens have got more environmental consciousness. Then business will be judged on their environmental track record. Suppose if an A industry could have a good track record, whatever that product they are manufacturing it, if they are able to do that life cycle analysis, and if they could prove that their impact, their particular product, not only at the manufacturing stage, but after the due usage of the particular product, it is being disposed in an environmentally friendly manner. If they could be able to prove that one, means that particular industry will have a more business, and their business can be judged based upon their environmental track record, because they are having a good track record with reference to the environmental aspects. Now, environment is no more considered as a private one, it is a public good. So, whatever that process they are employing, which causing very little damage or the zero discharge, thereby it protects the common property resources like air, water, soil, etc., means with the result the people will have a good image over the particular industry. With the result, that industry will have a good environmental track record. That particular product will be more preferred than any other product. With the result, that industry could be able to sustain for a long run. Then consumers will vote with their wallets by purchasing the products and services from companies with clear plans to reduce the carbon emissions and well-defined measures to minimize the environmental impact of their activities. This is the point just now only I have enlightened to you. That is, from the acquiring of the raw materials and after the due use of the particular product, if the company could be able to show that what the quantum of the environmental impact that is creating it, then that impact which is a very minimum one, if the industry could be able to prove that one, means definitely it will have a good image and the consumer will try to prefer their product than any other product. Then coming to the operational cost, rising of the operational cost due to stricter regulatory requirements and increased emission charges. So, operational cost may be increased, but the emission charges when you are able to reduce the carbon footprint or the release of the greenhouse gases reduced means, with the result whatever that income you whatever that expenditure you have incurred, that is being suitably compensated in the other way. Through either regulatory policies or voluntary commitments, carbon emissions will have an associated cost that will directly impact a business profitability and cash flow. Now, this is the thing which is going to come in the near, this is already coming, I can say. Now, if the carbon emissions have an associated cost, if the industry could calculate the quantum of the carbon footprint converted into that economic value, and that will have a direct impact on their business profitability. Business profitability in the sense they can put a little amount of the cost over the product, but in the long run, when more people are preferred that particular product, means even though the profit is less with one product, with one number, but because of the more number of the people who are purchasing it, with the result in the long run, this company could be able to sustain and then able to maintain the profitability in a long run. Over the time, this cost may escalate as more stringent policies emerge. Of course, that's what I have told you just in the previous point. Initially, the investment may be high, but tomorrow, when the policy regime is totally changed, you have compulsorily made to adopt this thing, means at that time, the quantum of the expenditure will be very high. So, for that reason, we can very well say the industries even themselves must come forward to adopt this technology of the latest one, thereby the energy consumption is less and leaving the less carbon of footprint into the atmosphere. Going green will help the planet and generate high profit. This is the watchword. Then reducing the carbon footprint. This is what ultimately we wanted to discuss. Then for the purpose of reducing the carbon footprint, what are all the various requirements? First one, technological developments. Second one, better process and product management. Third one, changed green public or private procurement. First one, technology development. Even in the previous lectures, I have said, for in order to have an effective environmental management, the three E's are essential. The first E is the engineering E, second E is the education E, the third E is the enforcement E. The first E, namely the engineering E, is nothing but infusing the scientific principles, integrating with the engineering one and develop the technological one. With the result, there is an advancement of technology, means automatically there will be an optimum use of energy and minimum exploitation of the natural resources and more quantum of the product at less cost. With the result, the quantum of the footprint, which is the quantum of the carbon footprint, which is left by this particular product, will be less. Second one, better process and product management. Again, the days have gone where we could be able to see only the product management. How the product comes, we never bother about the process. Now, the days have changed. That is not only the product management, but also what process which is being employed. Here, the end pipe treatment is slowly going away and integrating or the reducing, recycling, reuse within the process itself is gaining the momentum. Now, it has become the watchword to use the best available technology. The end pipe treatment is slowly fading away. Now, the best available technology is slowly inducting into the manufacturing process. Then, changed green public or private procurement. Here, that private and the public, whenever they wanted to procure that materials, if they have got the certification, this particular thing is environmentally friendly. This particular product, not only the product, but also the manufacturing process of the particular product was environmentally friendly and it is a green in nature. If you could able to get the certification, that product will have the more procurement both at the public as well as the private. Procure the goods, services and works with a reduced environmental impact throughout their life cycle. In my previous slides, I have clearly explained what is a life cycle analysis. I have also explained what is an environmental impact. Now, these two are integrating together. The purpose, the ultimate aim is to reduce the carbon footprint. Then the specific GPP, criteria developed for a number of the priority product group services. Again, it is the order of the day. This is slowly increasing it. People will try to prefer more environmentally friendly products, and the companies which are practicing more environmentally friendly technology could be able to survive in the future. It is not only because of the consumers change in the purview or change in the mind setup, but the people are becoming more environmental conscious. Again, this will become the compulsory one rather than the voluntary one. When issuing a call for tenders or products or services, these criteria are used as a part of tendering documents. Again, at present, even though we are not following, but it is not very far off. The day is not far off. Now, even in the tendering process itself, this will be coming, that how far your products, your process is be green in nature. Then your process are green in nature, then only you can able to file a tender. That type of a qualification for the tenderer will going to come in the near future. Then only products that achieve this GPP criteria are considered for the contract. Then carbon capture. Carbon capture in the sense, how far the afforestation programs you are going to induct in your industrial things. That is, when you are able to remove so much amount of the forest cover, or when you are going to remove so much cover of the vegetation, then how much cover you are going to increase it by planting more number of the trees, thereby the carbon capture is going to be increased. Unless otherwise you show a balance, or you have to show more than that, then only you can able to survive. Then consumption strategies and others. Consumption strategies, again, if your consumption happen to be environmentally friendly, that type of the consumption will going to survive rather than the unfriendly consumption practices. Now, the most important, the construction industry is assuming a greater importance nowadays. Lot of construction works are going on. It is not a small house. Even the very big, big projects are coming up. Now, it has become mandatory for any type of the construction industry to reduce the carbon footprint. What are the various footprints with reference to the industry? First one, with reference to even the construction industry, first one, construction materials. What type of the construction materials they are going to use it? Then construction activities or the construction process. Construction activities in the sense, how far your activities are going to be environmentally friendly and releases less carbon footprint. Then third one, lifespan operation. It is not the one time one. Till the building is going to be demolished, after the demolition of the building, how far that waste products are going to be properly treated and disposed from that environment, that thing also have to be taken into consideration as a lifespan operation. The fourth one, eventual demolition. If suddenly because of some other factor that the building has naturally collapsed, or because of some other natural factors the building is collapsed, again you have to induct a process in such a way that the waste products have to be properly disposed of in an environmentally friendly manner, and that process must leave less carbon footprint into the atmosphere. With the construction sector accounting for upwards of the 50% of the greenhouse gases, it has become a mission critical to the construction industry to look always to minimize their footprint. This is the order of the day. The first and the foremost, with reference to the construction industry, the recycling of the waste. The Environmental Protection Agency of the United States, EPA, estimates that up to 85% of the construction waste is actually recyclable. But the question mark comes, are we doing that recycling? This is the question mark. The EPA is very much suggesting 85% is recyclable. But again, how much we are recycling? Second one, a major opportunity to improve the environmental impact of construction, are that during the process of the construction, what impact it creates on the environment, either air, water, soil, and how this environmental impact can be minimized and what mitigation measures can be adopted. Many construction companies send their waste straight to the landfills when most building materials with the right process and services be recycled. This is what the present situation in the construction industry. Though EPA has said 85% are recyclable, but most of the construction companies send their waste only for the landfills and for the purpose of filling up the building materials are being used. See, many construction companies send their waste to the landfills when most building materials with the right processes and services can be recycled. Now, in just a minute back, I said the United Nations Environmental Protection Agency has said that nearly 85% of the building waste are recyclable. But what we are doing it at present, we are not recycling it, we are sending it for the landfills, and even though the building materials are recyclable. And the next one, products that include recycled content can be reused. This is not only reduces the energy consumed to make the end product, it involves the use of product that would otherwise be sent to the landfill. So, we must as much as possible, as far as possible, we must see how far that particular waste can be recycled, reused. Then if it is not recyclable, then only it has to be sent for the landfill for the dumping purposes. So, in summary, so far we have discussed the need for reducing the greenhouse gases. Then, in the consumer point of view, in the operational point of view, what is the necessity for the reducing of the greenhouse gases? Then, the various factors for reducing the carbon footprint. The last one we have discussed, construction industry and the carbon footprint. Now, I am going to put the questions. Why the emissions of greenhouse gases must be reduced? Second one, explain on consumer point of view and operational cost point of view of reducing the climate change. Third one, what is construction industry footprint? Thank you very much.